Lord, we give you thanks and praise and honor and glory for the day. This is a day that you have made, Lord. We rejoice with thankful in it. It is a day where we celebrate your birth. It did not occur on December 25th. We're aware of that. We don't know the day, Lord. This is a day that we have set aside to honor your birth. Our First Lady has talked about the trials and challenges that we are experiencing. Lord, we pray your presence with everybody on the line this morning, everybody on Facebook and Zoom and wherever they may be, as we meditate on the ideal Christmas. We lift this prayer to you now in the name of Jesus and for your sake, Lord. Amen. Amen. All right. I'm looking for a message. Amen. Amen. And I want to read from Luke. Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to him, her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in clothes and placed him in a manger because there was no room in the inn. Amen, and God bless you, and good morning. The ideal Christmas. I know that many, including this Christian right here, your pastor, has had a challenging time moving into the Christmas spirit. It feels, for some reason, maybe many reasons, as if we are not experiencing what I'm going to talk about in a little bit, which is the ideal Christmas. Certainly, first and foremost, we are in our second year of the pandemic, which looms in many ways over our lives, some very directly, some in the background, some a little bit in the middle. We have had in our city a lot of death and homicide. And as a result of the pandemic, we have not yet been able to gather the way that we have in the past for all humans. And perhaps in particular, those of us who call on the name of the Lord, gathering is so fundamental to who we are. And so we've not been able to gather the way that we want to gather in the world. And so it doesn't feel like, to many, the ideal Christmas. But at the same time, I want us to reflect on Christmas, on the ideal Christmas. Surely, if we have a lot of ideas, and the more we live, we have had better Christmas days and worse Christmas days. And we have in our minds set what an ideal Christmas is. And there are surely some that are better than others. But if there is a singular Christmas to reflect on as ideal, then it must be this Christmas that we find in Luke chapter 2. For it is indeed the moment that we celebrate the birth of the Christ. And as we think about our challenges, which are very real, very challenging, very difficult, let us be reminded that the ideal Christmas, the Christmas, came in the midst of challenge, came in the midst of strife. What do I mean when I say that? If I go all the way back over to Matthew, making my way there, all the way over to Matthew chapter 2, we know that there was a king, King Herod, who did everything that he could to stop the birth of Christ and to kill Christ upon his birth. So when Christ came into the land, when Christ came into the world, we saw the young people singing about Emmanuel, God with us. He came in the world in the midst of violence, in the midst of a corrupt king who thought to do harm and perpetrated death on so many folks. And it is, in fact, this world into which Christ came. Here in our text, we see in Luke chapter 2, again, it says, in those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. In the midst of the world and the activities and actions of the government, we see the moment of a Roman Empire and the activity of Caesar Augustus issuing a governmental decree, a mandate, if you will. We see not only the ruler of the empire and Caesar Augustus, but also the local government, Quirinius, the governor of Syria. Christ entered into human history during human moments, during human trials and challenges. And the impact of the empire and the governor was felt on a local level. The text tells us that everyone went to their own town to register. Everyone was responsible to be responsive to this edict. Next verse says, so also Joseph went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. It is part of the narrative of the family of God. Christ's father and Christ's mother were impacted by the laws of the land, by what was happening in the world. They had to travel. They perhaps had to travel in inconvenient ways and ending up in an inconvenient space. On this, the first Christmas, the first celebration of Christ coming to us and entering into the world and being Emmanuel, God with us in the midst of storm, in the midst of what's going on in the world. The text tells us they went from Nazareth to Galilee to Judea to Bethlehem to be responsive to what was happening in the world. This is not to say that what is happening in the world was necessarily good or bad, because on any given day, it could be a little bit of both. On some days, there's some marvelous times and celebrations and people are on one accord. On other days, there's fracturedness and segregation and death and plenty days of poverty and homelessness and strife. But it is to say that in this moment, in Luke chapter 2, when the Lord sent his only begotten son, when the Lord elected to leave heaven and to come down and be present amongst his people, because his people, you and me and the world, needed a Prince of Peace, needed a Savior, needed a Redeemer, needed the representation of love here on earth to be present in a time of strife, that this was Christmas. This is how and when the Lord came. What is happening in the world in any given moment is real. Whatever is happening in our lives right now is real. And it's a challenge for some of us in this moment. Some of us are experiencing lost loved ones. Many are experiencing their first Christmas without. And it's heavy and it's weighty and the weight is real. And this is why we see how Jesus came, humble, meek, mild, as an infant, a symbol of hope in a swirl of confusion, a symbol of hope in a time of challenge. A new child is born unto us. And this is the ideal Christmas. When we see Christ entering in, when we see the hope and the ray of hope, when we see new life, new opportunities, new possibilities, not necessarily on the best of days, but even on the most challenging of days. The writers and guides saw it as important enough to give us this detail in the text to let us know that Christmas, that Christ's birth emerges in the midst of what is happening in the world. In fact, if it didn't happen that way, it would strip away a whole lot of gospel songs. It would strip away a whole lot of hymns. There'd be no point in even saying Emmanuel, God with us, because or that he would never leave us nor forsake us, because it is his presence that is indeed the gift. It has an impact in the world, and it had an impact, my brothers and sisters in Christ, even on this young family. We are to be in the world, but not of the world. We should have an awareness of what is happening in the world around us. God has given us the Bible. He's given us a book that is rich in describing what was happening in the world around the church at the time of Christ's birth. It is a part of his birth narrative that we see the impact on the world around him. It had an impact on his mother. It had an impact on his father. It had an impact on the family. It had an impact on where and when and how Christ was born. We're experiencing the world today, December 25th, 2021. There are things going on from coast to coast, city to city, in our homes, in our families, hospital rooms, right now. And they have an impact on us. And this is the critical reason that the Lord entered, why we see God and we celebrate God and the birth of Christ. Next verse, it says, he went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. They went to register. They were married. Mary had been pledged. Mary was pregnant. There was no room at the inn. All of these things are real happenings in the world to this first family. We know from a couple years ago preaching during this season, we talked about choosing, and we talked about the choosing that Joseph had to make as a young father. Joseph could have chose to break camp. He could have been unpersuaded by the word of God. He was pledged somewhere, somebody, some brothers were mocking Joseph because they were supposed to be married and the sister was already pregnant. The math was not working out. A real world situation. Joseph, in this narrative, chose to hear from God and to remain. What about Mary? Real world situation. On the ideal Christmas, y'all remember this, if there's any Christmas that's ideal, it's the one that occurs in Luke chapter 2, for it is the Christmas, the birth. And praise God for Christmases that are the best and vibrant and joy-filled, and I pray that's what the Lord does for each and every one of us. However, let us also see that this Christmas, in the essence of it, a part of it, is this celebrating the entrance of Christ into challenging times. This Mary was pledged to be married, and you know, her belly was probably getting big. But she wasn't married yet. And somewhere there were some whispers and murmurs about Mary. Somebody maybe in her family, maybe some of her quote unquote friends, maybe some neighbors. They may not have said it to her face, but behind closed doors, because an ideal Christmas occurs in the reality of the world, somebody was whispering and murmuring about Mary on this Christmas, the Christmas day. And we know also that there was lack. Everybody didn't have what they needed. The world was not perfect. The world was challenging. The world was full of stuff in the same way it is today. Why do we say that? Because we know that at the end of the verse, it says she wrapped him in swaddling clothes, in cloths, placed him in a manger, because there was no room, no guest room available for them. It says in the NIV, no room in the inn, it says in the King James. There was no room for them. It was an awkward situation. The finances were not the way perhaps they would have liked them to be. The hospitality was not perhaps the way they needed to be. The economy had shifted. Maybe it was just a small town, but the point was they had some need, and the need was not fully met. That is the reality of the world that we're in. But right in the midst, here is the essence of the ideal Christmas, because we're celebrating Jesus's birth, right? That's the essence of this day, our King of Kings, our Lord of Lords, our Prince of Peace, our Alpha and Omega, our strong tower, our mighty fortress, our good shepherd, our lily in the valley, our rose in Sharon, our rock in a weary land, our shelter in a time of storm. We celebrate all of those. These are all the things he is to us and so much more, a liberator, a strong tower, a mighty fortress, all of these things, a redeemer, a forgiver, a savior is born. Unto us a savior has been born. This is the celebration. And so Christmas is about the birth of Christ. Then this is the verse we must celebrate, because it is the articulation of what happens. And we give high praise and we say hallelujah and glory. However, the moment was a quiet moment, as many God moments are. It was not trumpets. He did not crack the clouds and come through, could have on a chariot of fire. But here in a quiet place, in a lonely place, in a place even with some lack, in the context of Caesar Augustus and Herod and Quirinius and national goings on, this mother, this father, experienced this son. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. This is it. This is the ideal Christmas, that in the midst of the world, amen, in the midst of strife, in the midst of challenge, in the midst of uncertainty, in the midst of trial, in the midst of economy, in the midst of death, in the midst of a homicidal king, in the midst of politics, in the midst of a mandate, in the midst of less than ideal circumstances and situations, a child was given, a baby was born. This Jesus manifest in just times like these. My brothers and sisters, as we navigate December 25th, 2021, be gracious to yourself. Be gracious to your people. Look for God in the quiet moments. See him in the smile between you and your loved ones or your loved one. Go look in the mirror and see it in yourself. For you are fearfully and wonderfully made in God's likeness and God's image. See it in this mother and father, two or three, and Jesus together, two or three are gathered together, and God is in the midst. If you have a big tree or a little tree or no tree, if you got a bunch of gifts or a few gifts or one gift, our God is a God of love, and we can see and experience the ideal Christmas by remembering what's important, that he is a God of love, that he is a God of joy, that he is a God of peace, and that we have those things with us right now. If we want to celebrate the Lord, and we do, if we want to celebrate God, and we do, if we want to celebrate Christmas, and we do celebrate this moment, this ideal Christmas. If you're together, we're together now. I can celebrate you. You can celebrate me. We can celebrate one another. We have breath in our lungs. We have an opportunity yet to tell someone that we love them. Let us not take any of those things for granted, but let us be reminded to trust in the Lord, to celebrate this day of Christmas. And do know that if there is indeed an ideal Christmas, as we see in Luke chapter 2, that you made it to this day. And however you find yourself, wherever you find yourself, the Lord is near. And today's Christmas is indeed a ideal Christmas. God bless you. We love you. We give thanks and praise for you. Let us celebrate the birth of our Savior. Amen.